nu plus omega 5 n square p q nu plus q square
Can you maybe briefly explain again why Q mu W mu nu should vanish?
Which one?
Just the second part, last line.
Just this current conservation. Okay, so that is the assumption. Okay, so now. Okay, so I have here Q nu and P nu. Okay, so it's going to be minus W, sorry, omega. W1, Q nu. Then I have jiga here. Okay, plus W4 over n squared. P times Q plus W5 N square P times Q nu plus
Fernanda W4 should be Q square, right?
Yeah. That's right.
Otherwise,
I made a mistake. I made a mistake.
Yes,
because it's Q here. You're right. Thanks, Dina. Q square. Q square. Plus omega 2 or m square p times Q plus Q square omega W5 over M square P nu. Okay, so these guys are linearly independent, these two vectors. So the only way these guys to be zero is that this coefficient, they are separately equal to zero. Okay? So from here, from this expression, you get that W5 is minus PQ Q square W2. And, well, I'm not going to do it. You just make the replacement by W5 here, makes the zero, and then you find the relation between 4 and 1. Okay? So what you have is that W4 is m square over q square 1 plus pq square, or if I will, maybe better, pq over q square square solution. Okay? So we go back to make the replacements here, and we get our W mu nu. Okay, so W mu nu is going to be W1 minus G mu nu plus Q mu over Q square plus W2 over M square P mu minus PQ over Q square Q mu nu minus pq u square q nu. Okay? So that is the general form for our W nu in case of inelastic scattering over an unpolarized proton, supposing only one photon exchange. Very good. So now I said this guy here is Q square and Pn2, and so I will redefine this as omega 1 and 2. It's going to be 1 and 2 of Q square and U. Okay? We know that P times Q is related to the energy transfer in the vertex. Okay? Okay, good. So now we can go back and let's calculate this thing here again, okay, as we did last week. Okay. Now, before I do that, so if I go to a laboratory and make a scattering of electron in a proton and do an elastic scattering.
So, just to be
yes.
Sure,
yes.
You are summing over all the final states, right, of the final hadronic state.
I'm not tagging any final hadronic state, so in principle, it's all there.
So
as long as the energy momentum is conserved and all the quantum number is conserved,
right.
Okay?
But implicitly, you are summing overall hadronic states.
In principle, we'll be summing
state.
We are going to see. We are going to see very soon when I do in a more formal way this W mean U, as we approach the OPE. That's going to be very soon. That's going to be very, very, very clear that we are summing over all of them. Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyway, now if I go to the laboratory, okay, I can go back here and plug in this guy here to the calculation, and I can measure the cross-section. So if I go to the laboratory and make the measurement of these guys, so I should see the dependence of omega W1 and W2 with the momentum transfer and with the energy transfer. Okay? Now, surprisingly...
Fernando?
Yes?
Just to say, people can only see all this on board.
People can only see one board. Okay.
At any time.
Okay, so we are finished with this board now here, and we go to the next board.
Yes,
okay?
Yes,
very good. Okay. If I need this board here, I'll just let you know. Okay?
Thanks.
That we need that board. Okay. Anyway, so going back to the other board. Okay. Actually, I cannot see it. Yeah, now I can see myself. Very good. This is an important thing. This guy here is dependent on two variables. Now we go to the laboratory and make the measurement. And people indeed did this in the late 60s for the first time. They did it. They measured nu times omega 2 as a function of Q squared. So we should observe a Q square dependence. And they make this measurement, and what they observed was something like this. Okay. Instead of a curve, what they measured, doesn't matter now here what was the energy range they measured and so on, but it really doesn't matter. What matters is that they made the measurement at the time, and they found something like this. Instead of being dependent, as an assumption, on these two variables, they actually depend not on Q squared. Okay? So this was measured. So now we know from our previous previous lecture last week that when we do this kind of scattering and depends only one variable, that was very typical of elastic scattering. But here we are in elastic scattering, there should be two variables, not one. So the assumption was maybe what's really happening is that the electron is not scattering the whole proton elastically, but it's scattering some constituents inside the proton elastically. Now, if we can actually make the assumption and then do the calculation and saying that, okay, maybe the inelastic cross-section, the whole cross-section is just an, let's say, incoherent sum, so they are independent, incoherent sum of many elastic scattering between the electron, some of the constituents, then I can understand this kind of thing here. Okay?
I mean, is it independent of the value of Q?
Yeah.
If you go high enough?
Well, I'm telling you how it was then.
Okay.
Of course, we know today, because we know today that this guy is something like this. Okay. But by sheer luck at the time, they made a measurement in this region here of Q squared. Okay. Now, to understand this region here and this region here, it's a big thing. I mean, we understand this region here. I mean, we'll talk about that later. Up to a very good point, use perturbative QCD, but this region here is really, we have kind of lost the large X region. That's where we enter, actually. Okay. But anyway, this is further in our way, not now. Okay. So we can then go back. Let's go back to this guy. Okay. Well, I'll not redo the calculation again because it's exactly the same as we did last week. Okay? You just plug in, okay, using now this form for W and U, for W alpha beta, omega alpha, W alpha beta, make the contraction, okay, and you're going to get something like this, but not exactly like that. What we get is, and that's the reason I made this explicit calculation last week, so that now, if you want to, you can go back and redo this calculation here and verify yourself that this is true. Okay, anyway, this guy, okay, you see that, just to put the, fine, it's going to be something like W2 nu Q squared. Cosine square of theta over 2, and we have here, plus 2 W1 nu Q square sine. Just here is the coefficient term that we have here, but important thing, you have this guy here, and we don't have the delta function that we had before. Okay? So, now, you can see the following. Okay. So, let's suppose that this whole cross-section here, okay, is just the sum of many cross-sections like this one. So, in that you can think of these functions, W1 and W2, as a sum of many punctual scatterings between these electron and the constituent, something like this, okay? You have this guy, and you have the proton. Okay, now this guy can scatter between any of the constituents that I have inside this proton, okay? And the final thing, W1, W2, is going to be the sum of all the possible scatterings that you have in here, okay? In this sense, compare the two, you have that, 2W1. Point, I got here point-like to say that it's this point-like interaction between the photon and one of these families that we are supposing that they're families that they are inside the proton, okay? Then it's going to be Q squared compared to m squared nu. Minus q squared over 2m. Okay? Where m here is the mass of the point like object in the problem. Okay? So, if you will, so this guy is going to be q squared over 2m nu delta of 1 minus q squared over 2m nu. And the same for the other one, for the omega 2 one. So, W2 point, like, is going to be just a delta function of nu minus the square root 2m, or, if you will, nu times W2 point is going to be a delta of 1 minus q squared over 2 m nu. Okay? And now you see that indeed, now this guy depends only on one variable, okay? Because q squared and nu are just related to each other. Okay? Next one, please.
Assume that all the momentum transfer is done to one particle.
Each time, I mean the total, okay, the guy is catching here or here or here, okay, but the total one, you have to sum over all of them. The total W, the total omega, you have to sum over all the possible scatterings that you have in here. Okay, but the scattering at each time is between the electron and one of the constituents inside it at a different time. Okay. So, basically, I'm assuming this. Okay, I'm assuming that this vertex is basically the sum over j of this guy that we have here, okay? And now I introduce a new variable, x, okay? I will say that x is the fraction of the proton momentum that's being carried by each of these point-like objects, okay? So, I'll write here x is the fraction of the proton momentum carried by the point-like object. Okay, so this guy here may have some charge, so scattering has the square of the charge there, and fj of x. What is this fj? This is the probability to find the j component of the proton carrying x of its momentum. Okay? So let's write this down because that's important. So fj is the probability to find a point-like object having x of the proton. Okay, and here, W1 and 2, the JF 1 mu q squared. Okay. Of the JF, the J point like object that you have there. Okay. Now, we know that these guys here, actually, in this particular picture that I'm trying to design here, these guys are actually dependent on only one variable, okay? So let n w1 q squared mu go to an f1 omega, okay, of only one variable, and mu W2 q squared mu go to an F2 of omega when q squared goes to infinity. I mean, I'm really in the deep Alaska region. Mu squared goes to infinity, but omega equal to 2 mu over q squared fixed. Very good. Now let's use this and let's go back there and let's calculate this guy. Okay. W is going to be the sum of all J particles I have in there integrated over X AJ square FJ of X M, because this guy has an M there, okay, Q square over 4 m squared mu delta 1 minus q squared 2 m mu. Okay? And now, we assume actually that this guy is going to be useful for our future studies, that this guy is actually, it's a very, very large momentum in one direction, let's say the z direction. So that can have basically an infinite momentum, what we call an infinite momentum frame. So that's all these guys here are just parallel to each other. Okay? We don't have movement. You don't have transverse momentum in this guy. They are not going backwards and nothing. Okay. So just being the case, okay, then you can say that m is x m. Okay? So the proton, the mass of this spoon which is constituent, is just the fraction x of the total mass of the proton. Okay, so using this, so this guy is g squared fjx q squared over 4 x squared m mu delta 1 minus q squared can ask anything you want to.
I mean, this
doesn't mean I'm going to be able to enter it, but you can ask.
I mean, this M equals X times capital M is because we are in the lab frame.
Say it again?
It's because we are in the lab frame, or not. That's why M equals X times big M. Because this is M is the mass of the proton, right?
M is the mass of the proton, okay?
So if it's moving, this little M will not be X times big M.
I think it is. If you are in an infinite momentum frame, I think it is so. In the lab frame, it's a bit more complicated, I think, than this.
Okay.
In the lab frame, you have all this transverse momentum that you have to take into account. This guy's moving. It's basically, you can make this proton very large momentum in some direction so that all these guys are just parallel to each other, okay? So the momentum of this guy here is just an x of the parent one.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, this is okay. This is okay.
Yeah.
How do you make the connection to the mass?
Exactly.
If you want. Okay. And just guide the same velocity here. Okay. Anyway, we go here now because we have defined this W, okay? So this guy here can be 1/2x² W, okay? And this guy here, this delta, so then this guy is just the sum over j integral dx ej squared fj. X 1/2x omega delta x minus 1 over w. Okay. So you see that this fraction of momentum is just the inverse of this omega variable. Okay? So from here then we get this guy is actually, we have that f1 of x is just the sum over j 1/2 aj squared fj of x with x equal to q squared two. Okay. And you can do the same now for the other. Yes?
I think it might be very helpful if you just go through the arguments very shortly again, because you introduced a lot of invariables.
Okay, so go back and repeat it, everything.
No, just shortly, what you just to
Okay, so shortly then, we've seen that the scattering, the deep inelastic scattering of the electron in the proton could be parametrized in terms of two functions that are dependent on two variables in principle. Now we do the experiment, and we saw in the experiment that actually was dependent on only one variable. Okay? So the assumption made is that, okay, the scattering of only one variable is exactly what we observed when we saw the elastic scattering. Okay? So maybe then what's going on here is that the inelastic cross-section is just an incoherent sum of elastic scatterings between two point-like objects, exactly as we did in the case of electron muon. Okay? Then that assumption was made. Okay? And it's written in this equation here, okay? Assumption, where it was introduced an x variable saying that this x is just a fraction of the parent proton carried by the constituents of the proton. And f is just the probability to find a given constituent, one of the J constituents, carrying x of the fraction of the momentum of the proton. Okay? So while doing that, so I use the observation that these guys are actually dependent on only one variable. Instead of q squared nu, I define a new variable called omega, okay, by the delta function, and omega in the rest frame in general. You can say in general, these guys are 2pq over q squared. Okay? So depending on only one variable, which I call omega. Now, then I calculate what would be, using this relation here, what be F1 and F2 on this new variable. Then this is the calculation. Okay? And while doing the calculation, we can express this F1 in terms of a sum over these functions, these probabilities, to find one of the constituents, or the J constituent of the proton carrying x of its momentum. Okay. So I did this calculation for F1, and you can do the same now for F2. So for F2, so suppose that nu times W2 nu q squared is basically just F2 of omega. Okay? And do exactly the same. So F2 of omega is sum over J integral dx aj squared fj of x. And delta function 1 minus q squared 2m nu. Okay? We do exactly as we did there before, and then we have that f2x is just sum over j aj squared x times fj. Notice that now appears an x here. That's important, okay? It's basically before we had this guy here that would basically kill an x that comes out from the delta function. But now we don't have anymore, and now it shows up there. So this is actually the F2, what we call the F2 structure function of the proton in this very simple picture. Now, if I compare both see that f1 of x is just 1 over 2x f2 of x. Okay? This is called the Kalin-Ross relation. How interesting is this, okay? So, if I look at this expression like this, for instance, okay, I can say, okay, suppose, okay, the proton has certain number of constituents. So, if I can measure these guys in some different ways, so I can have information on the momentum distribution of these guys inside the proton, okay? Now, we know now that these constituents that are there are actually the quarks and gluons, okay? Now, so these J particles that we call it partons, they're actually quarks that are inside the proton. And these Fj that are there, they are the distribution or the quark distributions inside the proton. This is a very simple picture. The reality is much more complex than this, but that gives you a flavor on how this concept appears. Okay? We can actually go on now that we know that there are this cross-section actually in a limit can be described as, or the inelastic cross-section can be described as an incoherent sum of these objects in there. We can go on and build up a bit of more sophisticated thing, because we know, as Gina said before, but we know that these guys are not Q square independent, they are actually dependent, okay? And we can, as a matter of fact, understand at least a large part of this Q square dependence of this F1 that F2 that you appear using perturbative QCD, okay? Because you see, you made the assumption here that these guys here are completely free inside the proton, okay? They don't interact. When I say incoherent sum, what I say is that, you know, there's no effect. When I do the scattering of this electron in one of these quarks, let's say, okay? This quark is not affected whatsoever by the other quarks that are there, but we know that this is not true, okay? There are corrections to that. And the corrections to that come from QCD and so on. Okay, so we have to make a more sophisticated treatment of this object. Okay, we have to understand it.
The concept remains true also.
But the concept remains true. Okay, this very basic concept remains true. Okay, and it's important that we understand how this distribution show up now, because we can go now one step further, and let's make it a bit more sophisticated, the thing, okay? So, comes then to the fourth topic, that is the OP. I think I call OP only, but I will call OP and the IS. Okay? OPE is standing for operator product expansion, and DIS is standing for deep inelastic scattering. Okay? We call, going to the other board, we call this region, when Q square goes to infinity and E goes to infinity, we call this the deep inelastic region, okay? So that's why deep inelastic scattering, okay? So let's go back then to the hydraulic tensor. Good. So we have W, call it alpha beta now. Okay, this guy here depends on P and X, let's suppose, okay? Remember, we have this vertex here, okay? So P, the momentum entering, X, because the guy that's coming here, all the momentum that comes out here, okay? So, this is basically just the product of the currents that you have here in this vertex. So, and I said before, we are summing over all spins, summing over all S. And as Gina asked me before, we are summing over all X, over all final states. Okay? So, I have the products of the current, so I have this, is the matrix element of this current. Say, I'll call this point here, or if I will, zero, okay? The point zero, okay, in the Lorentz, in the coordinate space. Zero, proton, this is the complex conjugate, and X, J beta, zero, B. And some factor here, 2 pi to the 4, in a delta function, ensuring that QX minus Q minus Q. Okay.
Fernando,
yes.
One is small x and the other is big x.
It's always a big x. Okay. You said about x, isn't it? Yeah. It's always a capital x. Okay. I'm just calling this guy here always. This is my capital X, and this is my small x. Okay. So sorry, my letter is not so. Okay, so this guy is one over 4 pi. Sum over X, or sum over S, sum over X. So it's going to be P, J alpha, zero, X, X, J beta, zero, P, again, I'm going to do this step very slow, okay, step by step, just because it's very important, and I want everyone to follow, even if it's very boring, okay?
Can you say what is in the delta function?
Sorry. Okay.
So or you just did the star.
Yes, I just indeed. Okay, just. So 1 over 4 pi, sum over S, sum over X, integral. Now I will use the integral representation for this guy here, for this other function. Okay, so this integral of P, J for X, X, J beta, P, E, the minus I, PX, minus P, minus Q, T, Z, T4. Now, this guy here, actually, using the translational operators, you can rewrite this guy as, not the whole guy, but only the kernel. Replace this guy inside here, and then you have this operator here acting on the state X, and this operator here acting on the state P. Okay. And you see, you know, that you're going to have an exponential here in PZ and one exponential in PXZ that is going to combine with this one here. Okay. So if you do this, so this guy is 1 over 4 pi. And after doing that, okay, you're going to get rid of all the px dependence that you have in the exponential here. And then you can just sum over x over all the intermediate states that we have here. X can just, it's 1. Okay, it's a complete set of states. And then this guy is just sum over s. D4Z IQZ P J alpha Z J beta 0 P. Okay, yes.
Say it again.
I mean, you say, well, I sum over all states and so on, and then this is a unit, but there's still the electron in your scattering process. I mean, this is there. I mean, you cannot neglect this quantum mechanically. You cannot say there's this electron and I'm now forgetting all these. So, I mean, there might also be an electron, for example, being produced in your final state.
I don't think you can have electron in your final electron positron, maybe.
Well, exactly, but there is an electron which we then cannot, if you have an electron positron in your final state, then there is an electron which you cannot quantum mechanically, you cannot distinguish from the one which you had in your scattering.
Yeah, but you see, you are not looking at them. You're just summing over it.
No, I cannot. I'm summing over it.
It's different. The electron up there, you're just taking track of it.
But you detect at least one electron in the final state. This is given, right?
I don't hear.
I mean, the final state always has an electron.
Always.
So it's detected.
Yeah,
you basically
assume that it's the one up there and not the one
not
coming
necessarily.
From. Otherwise, you couldn't do this.
But isn't this whole stuff anyhow only in the strong interaction?
Here is defined in a state or in a theory without electrons and without.
I think what will happen in your experiment is this X. It will decay into everything which the proton and the photon can decay in. There will certainly, as Fernanda said, will also be electron positrons be produced. I mean, they are quite likely.
Yeah.
But in higher order in the electron.
I think you want to hear an argument which doesn't refer to any order in any direction, no?
Yeah, but your Fox state here is only strong in the nothing. So
I think this is not what you want here.
You think you want to have one?
Yeah. I think that what I don't know that is, but I think the point is that you always get the electron coming out. Now, you are saying maybe not the electron I started with, but I don't think it matters. I think, but I'm not sure.
I'm just asking. I really don't know.
being a one photon exchange, right?
Yes.
As well.
Yeah.
This is an assumption, right?
But I mean, the whole stuff here, you can write down without electromagnetic thing anymore as a dynamical variable. Fine.
No, but I think there are two assumptions. I think the first assumption is that it's one photon exchange.
Yeah, it's would have an interference, right? And this necessarily means multiple photon exchange.
I think that's
yeah, multiple photon exchange, then I can see some interference terms. Mm-hmm. And then you can. Can I go on? Okay, so our hadronic tensor then can be written like the expectation value of these products of currents. Okay. Now we can actually do a bit more. With this expression, now notice that if I have the opposite d for z. Z B J alpha zero, sorry, J beta J alpha Z. Okay, just inverting the order. Okay. Okay, I'm not going to rewrite everything again, but you can go like stepping backwards here. Okay. And you have that this guy is sum over s, sum over x, 2 pi to the 4 delta px minus p plus q times p j beta 0 x. J alpha 0 p. Okay? Now this guy here is 0. Okay? And that's going to be an exercise. It's a very simple one. Show that this is the case.
Okay. Everybody was hoping that you had talked about the exercise.
There will be two or three exercises today. There are more coming. Okay?
Well, speaking of exercise, maybe it would be nice at the end to shortly discuss the last exercise.
Yes, after we don't need to do it with everybody. I mean, no, just. So. If this is true, okay, then we can actually replace this guy here by the commutator of the currents. Okay? So this being true, so I have that W alpha beta P is going to be 1 over 4 pi sum over the spins d4 z qv p j alpha v is 0 for z squared is more than 0, because there has to be a causality relation. Okay? So, if this guy is 0 for z squared is more than 0, so I just have the option that this guy is more bigger or equal to 0. Okay? Causality. So, now there is something called Riemann Lebesgue theorem. Okay? It just says that if a function f of q is an ordinary function, and g of x is its Fourier transform, then I'm calling not x, calling z, g of z goes to 0 as modulus of z goes to infinity, basically. Okay, so I think that is a function that is integrable everywhere. Cal?
Analytic function.
It's an analytic function that's integrable.
Is it L2?
Say it again?
Is it L2?
What's L2? It's
square integrable. Yeah.
But, okay, it's. I think it has derivatives to all orders.
So that is analytic.
Yeah. Anyway, we have something like this here. We have a Fourier transform of a function. Suppose that this guy is analytic everywhere. Okay. So it means that the contribution just of this integral comes only when q times z is finite. Okay. So main contribution comes from qz finite. Say it again.
If we assume this,
then just if q is an ordinary function, gz is the Fourier transform, or actually here we have the opposite. Okay. Then as gz goes to 0 as z goes to infinity. Okay. So in the infinities of this guy here, this integral should be 0. So the main contribution of the integral comes from when gz q times z here is finite. That's the philosophy behind it. Okay. Which you can understand actually in infinity, these guys here oscillate completely. They minor plus and minus, and then they should cancel each other. So the contribution really comes from qv finite, or the main contribution comes from q times z time q so times z finite. Okay?
Actually, what we need is this function to go to zero as z goes to infinity.
Yeah, basically.
I mean, for this statement.
Or the integral, not the function, the integral. Okay. Or the Fourier transform of it. Okay, anyway, so just to make things easier, I mean, we can suppose that this photon exchanged, okay, as I said, this guy varies rapidly in the z direction, this photon exchange is in only in the z direction, okay? So q times z is just q plus z minus plus q minus z plus. The transverse part moves to zero, okay? Using light point coordinates. Now q plus is 1 over the square root of 2 of q zero plus three. Okay.
So the z component is new. What is it? New times q squared?
Q times qz is q plus z minus plus q minus z plus. And you would have here minus q squared z. Okay, but this guy is zero.
Can I make a suggestion for number?
Yeah. Yes. To stop here?
Stop here, maybe wait for questions, and maybe start directly here again.
That's fine for me. I mean, so I have...
I think we can even leave it on the board.
Okay, okay.
Nobody will erase it.
Okay.
Maybe not.
Okay, because it's late already? Yes.
It's late, and I think it's... no, at least I have difficulties to follow.
To follow from now on? Okay. Okay.
It's
no.
It's a measurable function that is.
We can stop here. Yes, of course. I mean, that's fine to me. Okay. I lost track of the time. I was going through the whole OPE now and derived all the moments and so on. That's a long. Well, that's an important thing. But maybe you're right. Okay.
Exactly. It's too important that.
Yeah.
I think we should
okay.
have full concentration on that.
Okay. That's fine. Okay. Okay. That's fine to me then.
So are there questions? I mean, also questions from Italy, Frankfurt, and Cyprus are welcome. That's also from here.
I have a question about this. We had run a tensor at the start, so you just introduced it. So, but was there kind of a reason why you did that, or because I perhaps I did not get how you get from the last section to this hadronic tensor?
Well, but no,
just like
GT general. What you have is a vertex, okay? And you calculate this pair of this guy. So what you have in the vertex have the current. So when you calculate this guy, it's the current times the complex conjugate of this guy.
Okay.
That's basically what.
Ah, okay.
what you're doing. Okay, that's exactly, just because now I'm not writing down the form of the current explicitly, okay? But remember, as we did last time, remember the electron. We have something like this, okay? So we have a gamma mu here. So when you wrote down the L mu nu, was just what? Was u bar gamma mu, or gamma mu u bar gamma nu u, okay? And these guys here, they were just the current, okay? The current that you have here in the vertex and the current that you have here in the vertex.
Yeah.
I'm doing exactly the same here.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. Just because I'm not specifying exactly what's the current, because I don't know. Why we don't know? Because I don't know the vertex. Mm-hmm. That's the whole point now, because I have to leave it open in terms of this current. And the whole point of the next lecture is going that we are going to make a general decomposition of this current in terms of some operators that I have no idea what they are in principle, but I can systematically categorize them and see by some symmetry what is their composition, okay? More questions?
Any question from Cyprus or from somewhere else?